Okay, welcome all of you. Good evening. We have another session today. It's by Zishan. Good friend of mine. He's been studying so many taxa. Reptiles, amphibians, spiders, tarantula, snakes, all kind of things. He's one of the well-known researcher in India. Young chap, but he's published almost more than 50, 60 papers, all in well-reputed journals across the world. And also he described over 30 or 40 species new to science and all, including some sub-family of spiders. So anyway, over to you, Zishan. I think you can take over from there. Thank you so much to agreeing to give a talk.
Thank you, David. And also like to thank you, everybody, for being there and taking time out of your schedule to be here and, join this webinar. I've been working on a lot of taxa, but largely restricted to reptiles, a few groups of amphibians, and arachnids. I've been working on scorpions and tarantulas. Though that's not entirely true, because tarantulas is a very common term that we hear. There are a lot of other spiders which are related to tarantulas that we are not well aware of. And I'll just give you a brief introduction as to why I started studying tarantulas and their kinds, and how one goes about identifying these spiders. So most of the work that I have done or have learned, I would say, was largely because of the biodiversity surveys that I undertook in and around Mumbai. This place called RML Colony in Mumbai is located in the southern part of Sanjay Gandhi National Park, which is quite close to my house. Me and my colleague would go there quite often, right since my school days, I would say. And we would largely go there in search of reptiles in order to get a sense of the diversity of reptiles in that area. And this work started around 2004 and continued all the way up to 2012. When I moved to Bangalore. But during these years, when I would go to look for reptiles, I did see a lot of other species which did interest me, but due to lack of literature, we could never pursue them. We did publish whatever we could on reptiles with help of a lot of colleagues and collaborators, but a lot of other species just remained unknown. We just have photographs or some details. How it all started with tarantulas was this one tarantula that we had seen. We've been seeing over these years, every monsoon or on the onset of monsoon, when we would visit RA, especially during the night, we would see these tarantulas all over the place, crossing roads, and we had to, in fact, be very careful as to where do we step or keep our hands on trees and stuff, because we would see this tarantula. And this is pretty large and it was very aggressive, as in if you were not careful, there was a time when I almost got bitten, because I placed my hand on the tree trunk and it was right next to my hand. But we never saw this tarantula in any other season. And we would wonder as to where would this tarantula live. But given that many of these spiders are so secretive, it's very hard to tell where would it. We also assume that probably it's an arboreal species and that's why we never see it. And we kept on surveying the area until one day we came across another tarantula which was very, 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 very different from what we had seen. At a digging site, me and my colleague, this was a site where they would dig out soil to make these bricks. And at this site, you can see the area which is highlighted in the red square. You can see that there's a mud embankment, and on the side, you can see the insect picture of the tarantula's abdomen. And this was the tarantula. This was clearly a female based on some morphological characters that people who work on spiders would be able to tell you, and I can brief it out in detail in the next few slides. This tarantula, we photographed it and sent it to a few experts who've been working on spiders. They said it's a trapdoor spider, but again, trapdoor spiders, we just found the burrow open. We found a single specimen. We never had any clue. We let the spider go, but it's in the year 2009, on one fine day, my colleague and I were in RML Colony, and usually we would just go around turning boulders. Am I there? Can people hear me? David?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, because there was some message which said there's a... okay. So my colleague was turning up boulders, and he asked me a question. Are there trapdoor spiders here? By then, I had only read about trapdoor spiders, and in there's not a lot of work done on these spiders in and around India. So, and leave alone Mumbai. So I told him, yeah, they could very well be. And he started describing a burrow, which said it is lined with heavy webbing. And it has a lid which is made out of the surrounding soil, and it's attached to the rock that he pulled up. And I said, yeah, they very well may be there. And I said, how do you know so much? He's like, oh, because I can see one here. We dug up the burrow, and to our surprise, we found this very female, something which looked like this very female. And that's when we realized that this was a trapdoor spider, and that's why we never found this spider. Now, we had two different spiders. One, we surely knew that was a burrow, trapdoor burrow dwelling species. You can see the burrow on the left image. You can see the one which is the lid has been lifted up with a stick, and on the right you can see it's sealed. The burrow is almost indistinguishable from its surrounding. Nearly impossible. Even if you're sitting right next to it, you will probably not notice it. So over these years, we kept on surveying. Now we knew where to look for the spider. And we knew that this is a trapdoor spider, and given that we had an idea, we found a couple of them in several other localities in and around Mumbai. But we still did not know its identity. And one fine day, we just decided to compare some of the images that we had of this spider and the male that we had seen, and which we saw again in the subsequent monsoons. Only in 2009, we realized the male specimen that we had found, in fact, belongs to the same trapdoor spider species. There was this book, a phenomenal publication by the British naturalist Pocock in 1900s. With the help of that book, we narrowed down to these two species. This book was published in the 1900s, and these two species were described in 1899. Both these species, the Valides and Robustus, as you can see, were both described from Mathiran, and one was described based on a male, the other one was described based on a female. We compared all the characters, provided in the book with the details that we had collected, and it clearly matched. We communicated all the findings with one of our colleagues, and we also wrote to Dr. Robert Raven, who is an authority on Michaelomorph spiders of the world. And he confirmed that our identification was correct. And we published a paper saying that these two specimens that you see left, right, the male on the left and female on the right belong to a single species of a tarantula that was described in 1899 and had never been found ever again. So we not only rediscovered this species, but also showed that the male and female were described as two separate species, but in fact were one. And this is the paper that came out. So this was the beginning of my, interest and, pursuing tarantula studies. And as we continued, we found additional species of trapdoor spiders. We traveled across the Western Ghats in search of tarantulas and other Michaelomorph spiders. So now, what everybody knows, the tarantulas are spiders with like the highest spiders have the highest diversity of most arthropods. They occupy almost a lot of ecological regimes given their ability to disperse. And they have been studied extensively, I would say, largely because of their role as biological pest controllers. Some have been studied because they're medically important species with regards to their venom. And lately, the use of web, the spider's web, as a material, very, very strong material, which is said to be 10 times more stronger than steel of a strand of that same width. So given that, spiders have been studied. But if you see, on the other hand, Michaelomorph spiders or tarantulas and their kinds have been poorly documented. So what are Michaelomorph spiders or tarantulas? Spiders as a whole, the order is divided into two major groups. One is called as mesothelae, and the other one that includes Michaelomorphae and Araneomorphae. Araneomorphae are the common spiders that you see in and around your house, which make elaborate webs. These spiders have they're almost everywhere, but and they're much smaller compared to tarantulas. Tarantulas and other mycelomorph spiders are much larger. They are usually obligate burrowers. They have to live a life completely underground, largely in burrows, so that to ensure that they don't lose their body moisture and desiccate and die out. So mycelomorph spiders, you can see this is the old classification of mycelomorph spiders. You don't have to remember all of this, but this is just a classification. And every year with additional surveys, many new species, many new genera, subfamilies are discovered. And with the use of molecular data, using DNA to classify species, the old classification is changing by the day. And the family classification does not hold true. And even as we speak, there's a lot more work happening, and many families, genera are being split or merged, and the taxonomy keeps changing, and largely with invertebrates, because there's a lot more to be done. So here is the diversity of mycelomorph spiders. You can see there are so many shapes and sizes and you know, body types. But as a whole, something that is very common, I would like to go back to a few slides. You see the way, how are mycelomorph spiders different from other spiders is the way the chelicerae, the fang, is oriented and the way it works. It is said to be a slightly primitive way of capturing prey or attacking or biting. So that said, it's going to be much easier. The only thing is if you have a view of the spider, you just have to see if you can see the fangs from front, as you see in Araneomorphae. But in tarantulas, you may not be able to see the fang unless the spider lifts up or you turn it over. You see the orientation of the fang is downwards and inwards. So in India, we have the following families. And as I said, many of these have been changed. If you compare it with earlier literature, a lot of has been changed. Even in the last 1 to 2 years, a lot of these families have been split up. And I'm sure there's a lot more going to be split up. Something that we largely are aware of, as I said, are tarantulas. Tarantulas, because they are large, very easily seen, if not by most people, but at least during heavy monsoons, when the burrows get flooded, they step out, and people who live in slightly areas as far away from urban setting may actually come by these spiders. So tarantulas, again, as I said, they are burrow dwellers. Many of these species live in deep burrows underground. Some of them may have a lid like the one from Mumbai, the Validis. They have low dispersal ability, by which I mean because their body does not have a mechanism to retain moisture for longer time. They have the fear of losing out the moisture and dying. So they cannot disperse out as other spiders can be out in the garden. They're most strictly nocturnal. They will not step out of their burrow unless absolutely needed or if their burrow is destroyed or flooded with water. Now, identification of spiders is very, very difficult, largely just by looking at it. You may get some help based on the locality data, but again, many species can be sympatric, and multiple species and even genera can occur at the same locality. And the details that you may require to identify them cannot be seen in a live individual or even from photographs. There are over 65 species of tarantulas described from India, and more than 100 or maybe 110 species of mycelomorph spiders described from India. And given that it's very hard to find them on a regular survey, because they live under boulders in deep burrows, you need to spot them, dig them out. Only then you probably will to describe them or even identify them. So given that it's very hard, most of these spiders remain poorly studied. Now, what characters does one look at? Like if you look at these, except for you see the Haploplastus validus male on the left, okay, the bottom image, and the one just immediately above it, female. They look so different that one of the finest arachnologists in the 1899 described these two as separate species. So that makes life even more complicated. You need to wait for years, literally, to get a male as well as a female, and maybe even multiple individuals to be very sure, absolutely sure, to confirm they belong to the same species. Now, thankfully, we have the luxury of using DNA data to confirm it, but that's not always possible, and not possible for everybody. So how this is a general body plan of a tarantula, and something that makes a tarantula is a large-bodied spider. It doesn't have to be a very large animal. Spiders, tarantulas can be as large as the size of a dinner plate, but can be as small as a 1 rupee coin. It depends on what genera and what group of tarantula you're looking at. But in general, the body plan is like this. They are also called as cat-leg spiders. They're so called because the legs have a claw tuft, like how cats have. The claw tuft covers the claw, which also gives them the name cat-leg spiders. And that is one identification feature of this family. This is very common with another brush-footed spider family called Berichillidae. However, there are other very minute differences from which you can differentiate them, but I think Berichillidae are not very common and easy to find, unlike tarantulas. So tarantulas, if you see the image on the right-hand side, the fang region, the chilis ray, and then immediately next to it, there is something called as a maxilla. So these two structures in tarantulas are very important to even identify subfamily and genera. So you have to dissect them out to be able to tell what subfamily or genus it is. You leave alone species. Species is even more complicated, you have to compare a lot more details. Now, in order to do that, you need to have the specimen and dissect it open. And as you remove the maxilla, and look at the face, which is facing on the front side, you would see structures like these. You can see each of these structures are very distinct and different. Each represent a distinct genus. Now, in order to reach a subfamily or a genus, you would have to open up the spider, cut it up very carefully without damaging any other part, any other crucial organ, to ensure you don't lose out other details. Now, after you've dissected this structure, you compare it with existing literature, which says, oh, these spines are arranged in this manner, that manner, and that's how you tell what subfamily it is. These structures are very important, and they're not just there just for taxonomic need, but spiders, when tarantulas, are very aggressive. When you just accidentally touch them or accidentally provoke them or intensely provoke them, these spiders raise up their front pair of legs, show their fangs, and they rub their chilis ray, the fang region, with the maxilla. The chilis ray has a set of spines which rubs against these spines on the maxilla and produce a hissing sound. This hissing sound is not very loud, but still audible to a human ear. And the sound is made to deter away smaller predators which might try to eat it. And if you've watched documentaries on tarantulas from America, they rub their abdominal hair and flick off those hair, which are called eutrichating hair, which can cause irritation when inhaled or even when they land onto their skin. Those tarantulas are not very aggressive, unlike the tarantulas found in India and the old world, basically. So the sound here acts as a defense. And again, all of these spiders are venomous. That is a secondary, the last resort is to bite. As I said, the maxilla is one important structure. And if you see, to get finer, clearer details, one can do a scanning electron microscopy image. You see the on the top, top A and D, A and B basically, you can see how the spines on the fang are aligned. These spines rub against the figure F. These rub together to produce that hissing sound. And this is a genus called Selenocosmia, found in Northeast India and the whole of Southeast Asia. And if you compare it with earlier images, they're very, very distinct. So each genus has its own unique structure and alignment of those spines. Furthermore, tarantulas have, as I said, they are very aggressive, and it's a known fact that many spiders females eat up the male during courtship or mating. Now, in order to be safe, many of the Mygalomorph spiders that we know of bear these hooks on the front pair of legs. These are called as tibial spurs. You can see in ABC and the lower one, the spur on the upper panel is much slender, much more curved, whereas the one at the bottom is much more stout and curved. And you can see there's an accessory and an additional spur right at the bottom of it. So these characters are very, very important when you're separating genera or even species. And these spurs, these hooks, are not just there for taxonomic characters, but they're useful to lock the female while mating. So when the female is mating, the male uses these hooks to lock the female to ensure that it doesn't get eaten up. And in the, as soon as the mating is done, the male retreats. Many a times we do, when the monsoons are just about the heavy monsoon, we find many males without legs and stuff. So spiders generally are during mating, if they can't run away, the males detach their legs from the coxa and run away in order to survive. So the tibial spurs are also very, very important, largely in trapdoor spiders, I would say, because the way the spur is curved, the number of spines at the base of each spur is very, very identified and quite unique to each species. Additionally, you can look at other things like how this is one subfamily called Eumenophorinae of tarantulas, and shows how eyes are aligned. The distances between each eye, which eye is the largest, how are they aligned, can be used as characters to separate species. And finally, something very, very important is the genitalia. You dissect open the epicanum plate very carefully and clear up the genitalia. The shape of the genitalia is very important to be very sure of what genus or species it is. Now, this all, as I said, cannot be done in a live individual. And that's why a lot of this work has to be done on museum-based specimens. And the male reproductive organ is called as the palp bulb, and the female is the spermatica. The male and the female genitalia is so made that it's like a perfect match, or like a lock and key system, to ensure that there is no misidentification within the same group of spiders. So we take advantage of this, and genitalia is probably the best key in some groups to identify species, especially the first image, which is like a Y, like spermatica. This is the genus called Pisciofrictus. They are almost identical in their appearance, and almost many characters almost overlap. But the genitalia is quite unique in each species and is very, very useful. And as I said, once we have all these details, like how the chelicerae, the fang region in the image A, number of teeth on the fang region, then the spines at the base of those, the chelicerae, how are the cluster of spines arranged on figure B, the maxilla, then the genitalia, all of these coupled together help you reach the genus and species. Then with trapdoor spiders, again, tarantulas are quite diverse, but trapdoors are very, very hard, even more harder to find, because their burrows are almost indistinguishable and very hard to find, and they're much smaller compared to tarantulas. This is an image of a trapdoor spider from Mumbai. You can see three of these burrows open, and there is do you see my mouse, the cursor? David?
Yes, we can see it.
Yeah. So you can see where I placed my cursor. There is a burrow which is, the lid is shut, so you cannot distinguish. There are more burrows there, but you can't see them. So unless you open it up, it's impossible to see. That makes it even more difficult to document the diversity of these spiders. Next, this is a family of the trapdoor spider. Trapdoor nest or the trapdoor burrow is an adaptation which a lot of spiders have taken up to conceal themselves from predation, or basically a mechanism by which they can have a different strategy of hunting. The burrow of a trapdoor spider can be of different lengths, shape, and sizes. The main mechanism by which they hunt is there are fine trip lines of web irradiating out of the burrow's entrance, which are not visible. So as in, and the burrow is shut with the lid, which might be made out of the surrounding material. It could be moss, it could be leaves, it could be soil, it could be even the sticks, or even bark, pieces of bark. As in a prey or a predator approaches the burrow, it sends in vibrations through those fine trip lines. And the spider, based on a very sensitive sensory setae on the, that is sensory hairs on the leg, calculates the size of the prey, how far is it, prey or predator, based on the intensity of the vibrations. It prepares for an attack or prepares to lock the burrow. If it's a prey, the spider calculates and lunges out, grabs it, bites it, and pulls it back into the burrow. If it's a predator, the spider will hold on to the burrow's lid and hold it to its might. Literally, it's very, very hard. Even using a fine forceps to open it up might be difficult you'll have to struggle to open it up. So the commonest trapdoor spider family or members are called Idiopidae, or called the front-eyed trapdoor spiders. And I can tell you why they call front-eyed trapdoor spider. This is a close-up of the of a trapdoor spider female. You can see there are two eyes here, and the rest of the six are at the back. So clearly, this is a character of at least two of the genera of this family from India. One is Idiops, and the other one is Heligmomeris. These are quite common. In fact, they'll probably be found even in the most urban areas that I know of. Like, they're very common in Bangalore, even on NCBS campus, and even in the heart of the city, Bangalore, you probably find them. Me and my colleague discovered two different species occurring in Mumbai, so which clearly tells you they're probably everywhere. It's that we just need to find them. And the best time is the pre-monsoon showers. That's when the males mature. So many of these Michael Moss spiders mature with, in India at least, or especially the Western Ghats, they mature with the onset of monsoons. The male and female are nearly indistinguishable. On, as in when the male matures, it molts and leaves the burrow in search of a potential mate. And that's when you see many of these tarantulas, trapdoor spiders entering houses on the onset or during heavy monsoon, initial monsoon. Here are images of two of the species of trapdoor spiders that were, are recorded from Mumbai. The first two images you see in the top panel are females of the genus Idiops. They're nearly identical except for the lighting and the slight maybe difference that you see in color. But if you see many more individuals, they almost look identical. Very, very hard to tell apart. But the moment you look at the genitalia at the bottom panel, you can see it's very, very different. On the other hand, if you see the males of the same species, it's exactly the same order in which the previous slide is. So this is the male on the left of Idiops bombayensis, and on the right is Idiops rubrolimbatis. They look strikingly different from the female. Most Michael Moss spiders, if not all, are extremely sexually dimorphic. So it's very easy to tell apart the sexes, but it's very hard to tell if this male belongs to this species or this female belongs to that male. So that becomes tricky unless you find them in the same habitat, and that too at times becomes tricky. And at such times, what you need to resort to is using DNA data. But this is just the era when we're just beginning to get data, sequence many of the common spiders. So it might take longer to finish this work. Other trapdoor spiders, as I said, these were just trapdoor spiders. Is a trapdoor nest is an adaptation. So many other spiders also do, even not. There are many wool spiders, other gnathosid spiders also make similar trapdoor burrows. But among Michaelomorphs, the commonest one are Idiopidae. There is another group called the brush-footed trapdoor spiders, especially of the genus Sasson. They make their burrows, or rather they don't make it, but they occupy a cavity either on a rock with a lot of moss or on large, usually on tree trunks. So I don't know if you can spot, there's something, you can see there's some web and lightning here. And in the next slide, you'll see that's the burrow. So these spiders are very common, especially in coastal Tamil Nadu and nearly a whole of Kerala. And we've seen these quite commonly around rocks in Agastamalai Hill Range, and even the low elevation forests. They're even found on rocks and stuff along the roads, but nearly impossible to, you know, spot them unless you have a very keen eyesight, or you just focused and sitting there carefully looking for a rim of the burrow with some web. And this is the spider that bakes that burrow and lives within it. And there are many other trapdoor spiders which have even more complicated burrows, like this one. This is a work of Dr. Manju Siliwal, and here this is a burrow of this genus called Ponothil. They're largely found in Northeast India, but lately there are some reports from Peninsula India as well. The burrow you can see in on the left is is like a double door. So it's like a straight tube. The entrance of it is covered with one lid, and if at all you disturb, the spider runs onto the further and closes the second door which is within. And on the other hand, you can see it's slightly curved downwards. There are some other trapdoors which have like a pot-like structure with a single lid. There are some which make a Y-like structure. If you basically use a stick and try to just bother it from one side, it'll run out from the other end of it. So these spiders have a lot of different types of burrows, and the burrow shape and structure also can be used to narrow down to a group of spiders. But as I said, we just began to look at the diversity of Michaelmore spiders. Most of my work has been focused on tarantulas and theraphosid spiders. And a survey that me and my colleagues started from 2013, and we've collected a lot of spiders from across Western Ghats. We are in the process of revising the systematics, and one of them we did of the genus Plesiophryctus, which had 14 species in that genus. After examining the type specimens, the specimens based on which these species were described, these were in the Natural History Museum London, the Natural History Museum of Paris, we compared them. It just so turns out that many of the characters that were used to describe these species were quite nebulous. We compared them, and based on current understanding, only 4 species are left in that genus. The other 10 were transferred into different genera, and in fact, some represented even new genera. Similarly, the endemic tarantulas of Western Ghats, when we started the survey, we had 7 species on the list. And by the time we completed the survey in 2014, we had 7 additional species. So we had a total of 15. And I still have some sampling left to be done in southern Western Ghats of Tamil Nadu, where I've seen photographs of species which potentially belong to this endemic subfamily. So there's a long way to go in the, documenting the diversity of these tarantulas, and some work conducted in Northeast India still shows that there's a lot of immense diversity. And I think we need a lot more people to, work towards this to document the diversity of these tarantulas. Because as I said, if it takes about from 2007 to 2010 to just resolve the taxonomy of one species to get the male and female identified, imagine if we have to resolve taxonomy close to about 100 species. Probably, I don't know how many years would it take and how many people. So I think this was just a scratch on the work that is ongoing, and there's a lot more to be done. I'd like to thank NCBS for hosting me, Singinawa Conservation Foundation, Ruffords Foundation for supporting our work, Rajesh Sanap, Ayan Mondal, Manju Silival for all their help, data, as well as opinions, and their collaboration, which has been ongoing and helping us do this work. And thank you for being here and listening to me.
Thank you so much, Sijan. Hello?
Yeah.
So it was quick, and you did. There's a few questions I'll read out, so probably you can answer those. If you all have any questions, please come up and Zijan will answer all those. Okay, there's a question from Rubina Rajan. Are trapdoor spiders dependent entirely on prey that approaches their burrow voluntarily, or do they come out of their burrows to hunt? If the prey approaches voluntarily, does the trapdoor spider burrow have any special features to attract the prey?
As of now, what I know, there is nothing that attracts, because there's nothing visually, there. Like in these spiders called signature spiders, there is the stabilanthem, the signature that you see. A lot of people say that it is there to attract prey. Some say it is there to make sure that smaller birds don't destroy the web. There's nothing like that. We also tried to take images of the trapdoor burrow by exposing it to UV and see if there's any difference in the appearance of the burrow or the web is visible. So nothing attracts. So it's probably just by chance that these spiders attack the prey that they see. And We have done some experiments by which we take a small blade of grass and we try to lure the spider, but there is a limit to which the spider does not cross. It does not want to leave the safety of its burrow. So it will just lunge out only to a point where it can get back to the burrow.
Okay. Yeah. There's a question from Pfizer. How toxic is their venom?
As we do not know much about the venom, there have been some studies done, and there's this a lot of reports of people getting bitten and even dying by a bite of something called Chilobrachus assamensis from Northeast India. Now, we do not know if the bite, the venom is what is killing people. Is it just, just out of, being scared of the bite? And I know of a lot of people who've been bitten by these tarantulas, but it's majorly swelling, difficulty in breathing, but the pain eases off in a few weeks. But I haven't heard of any confirmed death that can be attributed to a tarantula bite in India, at least.
Okay. Mainly South India, how many species are available and how many species venomous?
One thing, all spiders are venomous and nearly all Mygalomorph spiders are more venomous, largely because of their size. It may not just be the toxic venom, but the copious amount of venom that is injected might actually be the cause of the immense pain. So almost everything is venomous, from a very small, tiny Plesiophryctus to the large Poecilotheria and other mustard tarantulas.
Okay. Do tarantulas eat baby snakes? In one of the very first images, there was something like a snake the spider was holding on to.
In which image? Sorry?
I think the first image you showed, there was an image with snake and a spider. One tarantula was feeding on the snake, I think.
Okay, hold on. I don't think that was the case.
This one. See that one below?
The one, the male?
The previous slide.
Oh, previous slide. No.
No, next.
Sorry.
Next slide. Next.
No. No, there. I don't think there is. Yeah, they are capable of, because as I said, there's anything that moves, and there are reports of tarantulas feeding on birds. There is a group of tarantulas called as bird eaters, Ornithoctanus. It's reported from Myanmar, and there are some unconfirmed reports from Northeast India. They're known to feed on birds. So the venom is quite powerful. In captivity, I know that tarantulas have fed on lizards. So I'm sure they're capable of feeding on snakes. And there is a documentary on National Geographic which showed a viper that was killed by a tarantula and eaten because it slithered into the burrow of the tarantula.
Okay. Well, there's a question from Ashwati. Can you tell about the venom they possess?
Venom?
They possess.
I have no idea about the venom because, I've been more interested in the systematics and the diversity than the venom. And I wouldn't be the right person to talk about venom. I'm sorry.
Okay. Is collecting tarantulas for illegal trade a big threat to conservation?
As I said, we really don't know the number of specimens that are going out. Indeed, there is no doubt that the tarantulas are going out. Habitat destruction itself is taking a heavy toll. Like if you go around Amboli, Coorg and stuff, even Wayanad, many places, the mud escarpments along roads have tarantulas all of them. So in a road widening project, almost there's a heavy death toll of tarantulas because of road widening. And I do not know how many tarantulas are actually going out. We've been trying to figure out a way. Is there a way to quantify it? But we've just been failing. But we know for sure tarantulas are going out, and largely from hill stations where there are a lot of foreign tourists who are coming in.
Yeah, someone else also asked us some words about their conservation and international pet trade smuggling.
Yeah. So the best way is there's nothing you can do with tarantulas that are going out or gone out. The way right now, I think, is to be wherever there's high tarantula diversity and density, it'll be nice that the locals are vigilant. If they see somebody digging, see, it's not easy that you can just go take a tarantula out. No, you have to dig in most cases. So if people, locals are vigilant, reporting it to the forest department, and if the forest department has these regular patrols, once you nab these people who are collecting tarantulas illegally right here, it's going to be much easier to deal with them. Because once the tarantulas don't have bones. Now, because of that, if you pass them through an X-ray, you can't detect them. So that's why many, not just tarantulas, many invertebrates are smuggled out of the country in this way. And even when it's covered by CITES, but the problem is, how, if you can't detect them, how do you catch somebody? So the best way is if we can catch people when they're collecting it and before they even, you know, leave the place from where they're collecting it. And I know in places like Amboli, there were a lot of tarantulas when I had visited long back. But the number of tarantulas that you see out in the open have reduced because of collection, because of maybe other reasons as well. But as far as I have heard lately, there are a lot of people, local naturalists, who are quite vigilant and ensure that nobody is digging, collecting. So I think if we replicate this elsewhere, it might be much easier to ensure that. I don't know if we can completely end it, and I hope we can somehow do that. But then the best way to start is being vigilant. And most importantly, yeah, just if you, you know, get somebody. We have names of some people who regularly collect and stuff. There are a lot of these scientific papers which foreign authors have described new species of scorpions, tarantulas from India without having permits. And these were collected after 2002, which clearly violates the Biodiversity Act. So if we basically also, somehow convince the international community that journal editors should reject papers which do not have Indian authors or native authors from, and most of these collections are happening from developing countries, not developed countries, because they have very stringent rules of publication and stuff. And unfortunately, invertebrates and not most of, even tarantulas being so, charismatic among spiders, they don't have any legal protection in the Wildlife Protection Act. And we were to have them included in the one of the schedules. That would be the best way to begin and to make it, the law more stringent towards collection and stuff, or by non-native researchers or people.
Okay. There's a question from Joel. Any reason why Rameshwaram has a local Sarsen and Poiciliatheria?
Yeah.
Is it because of the studies being done there? Any geological habitat reason?
No. Sorry. Can you repeat the question? Sorry.
Any reason why Rameshwaram has a local Sarsen and Poiciliatheria? Is it because of, what is Sarsen? Is it a different genus?
Tree dwelling trapdoor. See, Sarsen and Poiciliatheria, they almost occur in Simpatri everywhere. And Sarsen, given that there's very little data available, it's quite likely there are multiple species and very narrowly distributed. But it just so happened that people surveyed that area. There are many areas we've seen Sarsen in. But given that, as I said, you need the male, the female, and it's like one trip for a 2-3 day trip may not be fruitful. So Dr. Manju Siliwal has worked quite a bit in that region, and she was lucky not just to see a female, not just a new species. She saw the male, the female. She even saw courtship, so which made it very sure that, yes, this is indeed the same species that she was dealing with.
Okay, there's a question from Sham. While photographing a tarantula in a tree cavity in Kabani, I saw a slug crawl up the tree towards the same hollow. While I thought the slug was a good as dead, I found out that the tarantula let the slug in, and the slug made itself comfortable in the cavity just a few inches from tarantula. Please comment.
Tarantulas largely, I've seen them react to very sudden movements, like very, very sudden. A slug's movement is very slow, but just to add something, there is a family of frogs called Microhylidae. These frogs live in the burrow of tarantulas and scorpions, but I know for sure that tarantulas readily feed on frogs, but they do not feed on these. And there are people who have written about that the frog feeds on the ants and termites that enter the burrow, and in return, the tarantula gives protection and a refuge to these frogs. But some stuff that we've been planning to do, we suppose that these frogs have a chemical disguise. Either they are distasteful, or either it's a chemical which the tarantula does not, maybe something common between the tarantula or the arachnid with the frog, and that's why they don't eat. But largely, I think either it's distasteful or toxic. because the same frogs live among burrows of termites and even ants, whereas the ants and termites do not bother or do not harm the frog when the frog happily feeds on the termites. So there was a paper which clearly showed that there was some chemical which was common between the ants and the frog, because of which the ants cannot identify it as a threat or as a different organism. So I'm not sure about this, but it may very well be the case with slugs as well, though I do not know for sure.
What are the identification keys for spiders? Any books or any...
See, again, with spiders, as I said, there are close to 1,500 species of spiders in India, of which some 100, 120 species are Mygalomorph spiders. The reason I stick to Mygalomorph spiders is because I have been fortunate to go and examine the type specimen, the species, the specimen, the sole specimen based on which these species were described. So what happens is when someone writes a description in a book, it's how that person perceives that species to be. But there are many characters, details that are left out or were not noted down in the description. So I prefer comparing specimens. And taxonomy is all about comparing specimens, not descriptions or, you know, books. So I believe following a book, you may lead to a species group, but may not actually lead to the species. And so, you know, that's one of the things that anybody who's very serious about spiders or in general taxonomy of any group, you guys should focus on, you know, visiting museums and comparing specimens. And if you can, if you can't get access, there are many times there are no type specimens. These specimens are either not accessible, they're in obscure museums where you can't reach, or they are either lost, destroyed, as in case of ZSI, many of the specimens are lost. So in that case, you could go to the locality where these species were described, look for them, and then maybe you can compare it with that specimen that potentially might represent that species. But again, there could be a way that there could be multiple species of that group also found at the same locality. So it's quite a rigorous process, but if you start somewhere, it will happen, because the Tarantula survey that we conducted across Western Ghats, something we never thought we would find all of these species that were described. And we did find them. Not that they were not there, but just nobody looked for them. So if you start with any group, we should probably go to the, if you can't access the holotype or the type specimen, you can go to the locality and at least look for that spider.
Okay. There's a question from Anirudha Dharoy.
Who? Hello?
Yeah. Anirudha Dharoy, great talk. Do you see sexual dichromatism in trapdoor spiders? Also, have there been any work to see if the dichromatism is more in the UV range rather than the visible colors?
The only species which shows sort of polychromatism is the species called Haplocastus devmata. The younger ones have a lilac abdomen and a dark carapace. As in they grow older, the lilac coloration is lost and they turn almost dark brownish to black. So that's the only thing. I haven't seen the males of that species yet, so I can't comment. But it's not sexually dimorphic, but some species are almost identical. The males and females look similar, except for the males have much longer and slender legs. That's it. But yeah, I don't think so. Except for maybe two species which show this way, and one another one is Poicillotheria metallica, the metallic ornamental tarantula. It has this metallic blue sheen all over it. So yeah, just these two species I know.
There's a question from Sanjeev. You have mentioned that many males without limbs to escape from female. Whether they have regeneration capability of limbs.
Oh, yes. See, again, many of these tarantulas and trapdoors mature in 1/10 of their life. So after their mating is done, they die. So I'm sure they have the capability of regeneration, but they're almost about to die. Many of the specimens that we found, they're almost dead. They're motionless. They know they're alive, but they're not moving. So I know that spiders do regenerate their legs, and that's my master's thesis is on looking at regeneration of appendages in spiders.
Okay.
Yeah.
What's their average lifespan, tarantulas?
So average lifespan, I think so, is about 5 years. There are reports of trapdoor spiders living up to almost about 35 to 40 years, but I do not know that. I have read about this because my work is largely going to a field site from spending about a week or so, but we've never maintained these spiders. The only way you can study these is have a captive set up to maintain these spiders. That's the only way. And whatever data we have about even the commonest tarantula species from India is from the pet trade people who maintain these spiders in captivity. So no, like very little or almost negligible data from the wild.
Okay. What is the, how many species tarantulas distributed in Kerala? Do you have any count? Someone asking.
We are describing about some 6 new species in one of our upcoming papers. So this is some, there are some localities where I haven't sampled. So, and this is only of the subfamily Trigmophoinae. So I'm sure there's this subfamily Eumenophorinae, there could be many more. And I've seen photographs of tarantulas from the Gurukula sanctuary, and I don't even know what subfamily it is. So I think there are many more to be worked on, many more.
Okay. From one from Gaya Kandaswamy. What are the ecological services and significance of spiders?
They are majorly biological pest controllers, as I said. So that's their role. And also tarantulas also do take down other animals like snakes, lizards, and frogs, and maybe even mice and birds. And tarantulas are can be used as, you know, they're indicator species of a good habitat and stuff. Their density diversity also reflects that it's a very healthy and good habitat. So maybe it can be used as a flagship species for invertebrate conservation.
You can take few more questions. No, there's a few more questions are piling in. Are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay. There's a question from Nephila. Do you want to take that?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, asking about the Nephila philippus. Is there any blackish form, or they belongs to the same species?
I'm not sure what is it. There's something called as Nephila coolie or coolio. Yeah,
coolie, yeah.
Darkly black in color. So I'm not sure if you have the same species, but it could very well be I don't know if it's most likely should be coolie with red legs, but I don't know.
Okay. Without waiting for the pre-monsoon mate or search for males, how can you find an megalomorph?
So if you know the habitat, if you're looking specifically for a family, say tarantulas, Theraphosidae or tarantulas are much easier to find. The larger ones, you'll see them in burrows, and you can clearly see a large burrow lined with webbing. And the webbing of a tarantula and that of other spiders, like the funnel web spider, is very different. If you pull out the strings, you take the web and try to pull it apart of funnel web spider, it's much more sturdy, much more, it'll break though, and it doesn't stretch a lot. And it's, you can easily see each strand and stuff, but that of a tarantula is largely more, it looks like cotton, very fine, and it's the fibers can be pulled apart much longer, and it's much softer. So once you see a burrow with that kind of webbing, you know it's either a tarantula or some other megalomorph like the family called Diploridae. That is one indication of a tarantula burrow. But if you're looking for trapdoors largely are the best. They're almost everywhere, but it's much easier to find them along mud embankments, along roads, or if it's a large old tree, there'll be these mud slopes and stuff along the buttresses of the tree. You'll find a lot of them. There are places where we found like about 50 burrows around one huge boulder, which has this mud base. So they're highly concentrated in one place. Like the female gives lays eggs, and as soon as the hatchlings, many of them occupy the surrounding. So if you find one trapdoor spider, there are high chances you might find many around it.
Okay. Thank you.
There was a time when we found one while picking up a rock. We accidentally opened up a burrow for a trapdoor. To clear it, I used a spade to clear off the soil and the leaf litter. We ended up exposing 4 or 5 more burrows. So I think so. If you found one, you've hit jackpot. You'll find many more.
Okay. There's a question. What is the difference between Helicomeres and Idiops?
So as of now, there's one clear difference that is said, which I feel is too vague. There is a cavity on the third trochanter. I'm sorry using these terms, but yeah, there's a segment, basically, tibia. There's a segment of the leg called as the tibia. It has a depression, and the whole structure is saddle shaped, but I feel it's too vague character to call it as a separate genus. I will. We are in the process of sequencing some specimens of trapdoor spiders, and we'll see if it's really a different group. Another character, which is the genitalia, is slightly different. If you see that the two stalks of the genitalia are on top, and they're fused at base and supported by a plate, which is not the case with other idiops. Of the same clade, I would say. They are just two stalks arising. But here you can see a very, very big distinct plate separating it. I hope that helps.
Is there any venom bank for spiders? Somebody asked. I don't know what is it meant.
As far as I know, whatever Venomics proteomics data is there, it's available with the actual venom. No, not that I know of. Yeah, because getting permissions to work on a spider from the forest department is easy, but the moment the venom is involved, there are a hell lot of other things involved. And how do you get a very pure yield of the venom? Even if you are just a newbie trying to get it, you might end up contaminating, and that might not be a thing. So I really have no idea. I don't deal. There's Dr. Karthik Sonakar from ISC. He'd probably be the best person to talk about venom. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
There's a question. Apart from smuggling, is there any reason responsible for decline of their abundance, if at all, of megalomorphs? Any other?
I think so. More than collection, the biggest is habitat destruction. Yeah, because if I say that there are 50 odd burrows in one small area, something as simple as clearing the fire line in a forest, just running a JCP to clear up the make a fire line, you've destroyed, I don't know, so many burrows at once. So yeah, I think habitat destruction is a much bigger concern when it comes to, you know, local extinction of the population at a very given spot, I would say.
Okay, there's a question from Facebook Live. Can you say how to differentiate Gnaphosidae spiders from trapdoor spiders by viewing them?
So as I said, the biggest character is how the fangs are arranged. In the first few slides, if you want me to go back, I know they're quite confusing. I totally agree in field. But if you see, Gnaphosid spiders have much slender legs. And if you see a top view of Gnaphosid spiders, you won't see the fangs protruding out. The chelicerae don't protrude outwards. That you can possibly this figure. You can see how the fangs are. In Gnaphosid, they would be like this. They would operate like this. You can see the fangs from front. Whereas in a trapdoor spider, they would be like this. So,
okay. Any books to suggest?
So, if you are interested in general spiders, there are several books. But as such, for megalomorphs, there's nothing very, very, there's no popular read as such. There is a book by Dr. Robert Raven on a review of the infra-order megalomorphia of the world. It's probably the best compilation on Michelomorph spiders of the world. So if you're looking for that book, I think so that's freely available. You can just download the ebook. Yeah. But other spiders, again, as I said, we have 1,500 species. Of these, 500 were described by Dr. Tikka there from ZSI. Nearly 50% of these, nearly 250 or 300 of the specimens are lost. So we don't even know if these are even valid. So it's like 500 species described by a single person. So we don't know.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want to add something on the guys who are studying? A lot of youngsters have started studying spiders, megalomorph. How do you want to do them, proceed their studies? What quality study they have to look into it? What are any instruction for them?
So if they follow, most importantly, the International Code of Zoological Nomenclature is the best piece of information that is available. If you strictly adhere to the code, you'll probably not make mistakes. And with the advent of and the accessibility of barcoding, life has become much easier. Even if you describe a single new species, sequencing one gene, the barcode gene called cytochrome oxidase or CO1 gene, it's much easier and much cheaper. Even making that available makes it much better. And people, given that many of these journals these days do not have a charge for color publication or page length, give as many images as you can. No matter who you are, you may never be able to describe a species in great detail. Maybe currently the character was probably, say, oh, 5 spines on this area, or the number of the genitalia is this bilobed and stuff. But 10 years down the line, when now we're dealing with distinct species, the moment we get into a position where we are with reptiles right now, there are many cryptic species which are almost indistinguishable from their visual appearance. You have to look at many more characters. So when you describe something based on the current scenario, you may never be able to provide all the details that are required. So what you should do is provide as many photographs in high resolution good in the paper. Diagrams are good, but again, diagrams, they look fancy and everything. I really like diagrams, but you are highlighting what you want to show and what you see. But there are many characters, you don't see them now, but eventually maybe some researcher who might be with standard journals, they will thrash your paper, but they'll ensure that they make you do something which is good. And, you know, that's a very good way to start. Try focusing on journals which are standard. And there are a lot of people, if you follow work of, if it's largely tarantulas, if you see work done by Manju Siliwal, then work done by Robert Raven, and if Michael Ricks and Rick West, there are these people, if you follow their work, I think they're the best in the field right now. So.
Oh, thank you so much, Zijan. It was wonderful to hear you. And thank you so much for sparing some time for us. I mean, I know you're very busy. It took a lot of time to catch all of you. On behalf of both the Kottayam Nature Society and Alapine Naturalist Society and all those who attended, we extend our thanks and stay safe.
Thank you. Thank you so much.